The incident in the Volgograd region follows a similar confrontation in June, also in southern Russia. Venezuela's Attorney General has said the presidential opposition candidate, Edmundo González, will be asked to testify about his part in uploading voting records which appeared to give him a landslide win. Andrew Achian reports.
In a press conference, the Attorney General, Tarek William Saab, said a probe had been opened into what he called contempt and disobedience of laws by Mr. González. Venezuela's National Electoral Authority declared President Nicolas Maduro the winner of the election in July with just over half the votes. But tallies posted by the opposition, which they say are from the polling stations, show a resounding victory for Edmundo González. Earlier, the US and 10 Latin American countries rejected a ruling by Venezuela's Supreme Court endorsing Mr. Maduro's victory. A statement said the court lacked independence and impartiality.
Ukraine and India have issued a joint statement pledging to uphold the territorial integrity of sovereignty of countries after talks in Kiev between President Zelensky and India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Mr. Zelensky and his government have been unhappy at the continuing warmth of Delhi's ties with Moscow and Mr. Modi's failure to condemn the Russian invasion. But today, Mr. Zelensky said India was supportive.
In 1,000 feet, take the exit toward US 322 West, US 522 North.
Mr. Modi was invited first to see a memorial to the 570 Ukrainian children reported to have been killed since Russia's full-scale invasion. He said his last.
Take the exit toward US 322 West.
Later, Mr. Modi made a personal pledge to bring about peace talks between Ukraine and Russia.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto Kishakakia Street.
Ukraine's territorial integrity. He didn't mention that India has never condemned Russia's full-scale invasion.
This is the BBC News. The United States says some progress has been made in talks being held in Cairo aimed at trying to secure a ceasefire and the release of hostages in Gaza. The White House National Security Spokesman John Kirby said all sides now needed to come together and work towards implementation. Three fires are reported to be burning on a Greek-owned oil tanker that was hit earlier this week by the Houthis in Yemen. United Kingdom Maritime Trade Operations Agency says the Sunion appears to be adrift in the Red Sea. Earlier, the vessel's owner said they had been preparing an inspection. The head of the World Health Organization has said that plans to control the new Mpox outbreak will require at least $135 million over the next 6 months. In an address to the WHO member states, Tedros Ghebreyesus said the outbreak could be controlled, but it required...
At the light, turn right onto Kishakakia Street, then turn left onto Green Avenue.
Mercy Juma has been to Burundi, which has already confirmed more than 170 cases.
Medical officials in Burundi are not only concerned about a lack of awareness of the dangers of the disease, but also the limited resources available to fight it. There is only one testing laboratory in the whole country, insufficient testing kits, and no vaccines. One of the poorest countries in the world, Burundi borders the east of the Democratic Republic of Congo, where the current Mpox outbreak began. Despite no recorded deaths here yet, at least 170 people are infected, and that number is expected to rise.
Texas has teamed up with 15 other states to sue the Biden administration over a new program that offers a path to citizenship for some immigrants who are in the U.S. illegally. The scheme, called Keeping Families Together, applies mainly to the spouses of U.S.
Take the next left onto Green Avenue.
For more than a decade. And that is the BBC News.
Continue for 11 miles.
Hello and welcome to NewsHour from the BBC World Service, coming to you live from our studios in central London by Julian Marshall. We've been for weeks, but it's now official. Republican Donald Trump will go head-to-head with Democrat Kamala Harris in the November presidential election after her coronation at last night's Democratic National Convention. But they're not being the only runners in the race. There are a number of other candidates whose votes might affect the results in key swing states. Some names may be or may not be familiar to you. Jill Stein of the Green Party, Chase Oliver of the Libertarian Party. And then there's a name that does ring a bell, if only because of the name itself. Independent candidate Robert F. Kennedy Jr., son of the former U.S. Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy and nephew of former President John F. Kennedy, both slain by an assassin's bullet. But Mr. Kennedy, who, in case you're wondering, has a voice condition also endorsed Donald Trump at a news conference. A short while ago, he explained why.
Election comes around, they want more choice. voters come to recognize that they really only have two viable choices. And the vast majority of voters end up just sticking with one of the two major parties, even if they would favor some reforms that might make it easier for fourth or fifth parties to actually get some more votes.
Seth Baskett, many thanks to political science professor at the University of Denver. We can now speak live to Dan Junior, Republican strategist and pollster at North Star Opinion Research. And Mr. Dooley, President Trump, Donald Trump, seems very happy to have Bobby on board. Is he?
Yes, he seems to be. I mean, Bobby Kennedy did have, was still holding out as high as he was over the summer, but he was still holding in the mid to high single digits in some of the key states. And I think, you know, Donald Trump would love to get some of those voters in his category, especially now that he seems to be falling a little bit behind Kamala Harris.
And Robert F. Kennedy Jr. intends to take his name off the lists in a number of U.S. states. Is that significant?
It could be, because as your previous guest noted, one of the impacts a third-party candidate can have is as a spoiler for another candidate. And so in some of these swing states, they're likely to be very, very, very close in November. If he is on the ballot, taking votes away really from any candidate, it could have a significant influence on the outcome. If he's not on the ballots in those states, obviously somebody would have to write him in, and that means that he's just much more less likely to be a spoiler in the overall election.
In his endorsement, though, of Donald Trump, what does Robert F. Kennedy Jr. bring to the Republicans?
Well, to be honest, I don't know that he brings that much. A lot of the people who, and we saw this in our polling going back over the last year, a lot of the people who were supporting Kennedy were not supporting him because of any policy position. There were some folks who were, but most people were supporting him because he was not Joe Biden or Donald Trump. And they knew he was an effective protest vote. And he was an easy protest vote because he was a name that they had heard. Most people didn't know his platform, didn't know much about him, didn't know much what he stood for. Now that he's, now that the race has been shaken up by Joe Biden dropping out, there's just less room for a candidate like that, who is sort of the repository for the sort of anger that we saw in the rematch between Biden and Trump.
And your thoughts on the Trump-Harris competition, particularly after Harris being so energized by the Democratic National Convention?
It is likely to be very, very close. So Democrats, really up all the way through when Joe Biden dropped out, had been extremely unenthusiastic, if not demoralized. That is definitely not the case anymore. Democrats are very fired up. That's what's driving sort of the surge of Kamala Harris in the polls. And we're basically back to what we saw in 2016 and 2020, which is an extremely close race nationally and an extremely close race across the political swing states and electoral college.
Dan Junior, Republican strategist and pollster at North Star Opinion Research. Many thanks for joining us. India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi has used a visit to Ukraine to urge President Zelensky to enter into peace talks with Russia. Last month, Mr. Modi was criticized by the Ukrainian leader for visiting President Putin in Moscow, but he's now said he wants to act as a friend to try to bring about a truce. Our Europe correspondent Nick Bate reports from Kyiv, where the two leaders met today.
The most raucous reception for Narendra Modi in Kyiv came from a carefully choreographed gathering of fellow Indians. The Prime Minister shaking hands and shaking off our questions.
Why have you come to Ukraine, Mr. Prime Minister?
Last month, President Zelensky spoke of his huge disappointment at watching Mr. Modi warmly hug President Putin in Moscow on the day Russian missiles killed more than 40 people across Ukraine and hit the capital's biggest children's hospital. Today, it was President Zelensky's turn to be embraced, although this appeared a more awkward greeting. It seemed no coincidence that Mr. Modi was invited first to see a memorial to the 570
Russia's full-scale invasion. He said his heart was filled with grief for those martyred in the war. Later, Mr. Modi made a personal pledge to bring about peace talks between Ukraine and Russia.
Russia will be President Putin. I told him very clearly that problems cannot be resolved no matter how much I've done. But the only way of resolving problems is through dialogue and through diplomacy. Both sides will have to sit together and look for ways to come out of this crisis.
President Zelensky thanked his visitor for supporting Ukraine's territorial integrity. He didn't mention that India has never condemned Russia's full-scale invasion. Instead, it has strengthened economic ties with Moscow. Last month, Delhi overtook Beijing as the biggest importer of Russian oil in the face of Western sanctions, purchases which have provided welcome revenue for President Putin's war economy.
That was our Europe correspondent Nick Beek reporting from the Ukrainian capital, Kyiv. And don't forget, if you want to listen to News Hour but miss the live broadcast, podcasts of the program is available, updated twice a day. Just type into your search engine, BBC News Hour podcast, and you'll find it there. You can listen to a single edition, or better still, subscribe to the feed for regular downloads, so you'll never need to be without us.
North for 20 miles.
Talk about, usually tends to happen. Does it? Will we see it here? And do you think it matters overall?
We very well might. The Trump campaign didn't really get one, but it's also was something we couldn't really measure because no sooner had everybody flown home from Milwaukee when the race got completely turned on its head. So whether or not convention bumps are a thing that happens this year, we don't know. We'll find out in the next couple of days. But I suspect she might get a small bump, if only because she is somewhat more undefined. If this had been a convention nominating Joe Biden, I don't know how much it would change. Voters know Donald Trump and they know how they felt about Joe Biden. But there are enough voters that aren't sure how they felt about Kamala Harris. They probably weren't the were staying up until 11 midnight watching it, but they may have seen clips and said, let me give her a second look. Wouldn't surprise me if you don't see some of those undecideds at least briefly saying, I'm open to the idea of Kamala Harris.
Interesting question, because the Trump campaign is competing for them as well right now. We were talking before the show, I was out with the former president on a couple of his battleground steamships. Have they got their footing back on someone, right? He was in all the states, he's doing all these events. Where are they right now? Because this is a key point. At the end of the convention, we're all looking around, I've never seen the Republican Party this unified. They felt like they were on a glide path to 270 plus a lot. Everything has changed. What hasn't is he still has a 50-50 at worst shot at winning. What about the campaign?
Yeah, the campaign is, I think, finding its footing once again. Obviously, President Biden had promised that he was going to stay in. There was no way getting out. And so to have that kind of flipped on its script really did put everything aside. But I think when Vice President Harris named Walz, I think that kind of put everything back into perspective. You saw very strong pushback on his record, on the questions that his comments continue to raise. They were a little more prepared, I think, for that announcement and to come back and show the American people kind of more the truth of Governor Walz and where that lies. And I think that they're going to be just fine in pushing back, especially now that we saw so much fluff and not as much substance as we would have wanted to see from that convention.
And they clearly want him on a very specific message. You can see throughout the trail that event that we saw earlier in Nevada. It was tax on tips, small event, talk about the policy. Which makes this interesting, and I'm asking you, because we're both on the Hill together, there's kind of under the radar story of limitation for a gala at Trump's Bedminster Resort to, quote, honor and celebrate the January 6th defendants responsible for that January 6th prison choir song. Trump has been invited to speak. We don't know if he's going to speak. We talk about policies, message, and contrast, and then you get this.
Yeah. Look, I think when you're looking at what happened on January 6th, there were hundreds and hundreds of arrests made for violent activity and for absolute criminal activity that should have been made. What you subsequently saw was really aggressive prosecutions that went beyond the pale. Now, the Supreme Court has ruled 6-3, and not an ideological lies, by the way. Justice Jackson joined the majority, Amy Coney Barrett joined the dissent. But saying that it was overzealous, that they were charged for things that they should not have been charged for. They had plucked this obscure financial crime and tried to charge all of these defendants with this to enhance the criticism, to enhance the pleas, and to enhance ultimately the sentences, throwing hundreds of cases into question. And so I think having a fundraiser to pay for some of those legal fees is an interesting take. It is receiving more attention, I think, than maybe the attention that was received when Vice President Harris told everybody to donate to the Minnesota Freedom Fund.
The latter point is a political discussion. It's a fair political discussion to have. I think the thing I struck by the Trump point in the Sarbanes-Oxley debate, which I would absolutely love, not going to let it happen, but I understand the lawyer version of this, as you are known to be a very good one, but from a political perspective, on this issue, doing anything related to it seems a little bit bizarre to me.
Yeah, I mean, I think you'll notice he was invited. I don't know if the former president has decided to attend or not. I think there's a large contingency of America who believes that what they saw was massive hypocrisy and difference in treatment between violent offenders at different locations. And so that is sympathetic to a portion of the country.
This was something that Democrats elevated a lot and want to elevate a lot during their convention.
Yeah, I think that is a very weedsy analysis of what's going on here. I do not believe that most people will see it at that level. I think the very top line contrast is something that the Harris campaign should be salivating over, which is they made the theme of felon versus prosecutor a main one of the convention. This allows them to talk about it again and again and again. Look at this. Not only is he a criminal himself, but he's actually standing up on behalf of these other criminals. That is who he is. That's not America. I mean, I would love to have that set up if I were them.
Yeah, well, we'll see. He's not confirmed his attendance yet. We'll see. We do know it's going to be at his club, guys. Thank you very much. It's been a crazy week. Appreciate you coming in. And it's not just that January 6th gala at the Trump property. Political campaigns and committees have spent millions of dollars at Trump hotels and resorts. New CNN analysis next.
NBC hopes set our premier live audience event. Visit msnbc.com/democracy2024 to buy more tickets today.
Let's be clear about how we got here. Donald Trump hand-picked members of the United States Supreme Court.
going to be before voters this fall. Do we, an effort to overturn democracy suggests you don't trust voters' power and ability to make their own decisions. An effort to block or overturn reproductive freedom suggests you don't trust women to be able to know what's best for their own economic and life choices. And so all of that really says that we, the American citizens, deserve to be trusted in a democracy by those who lead our country is really a powerful framework for us all to think about as we select not just who we want to lead our country, but who we want to lead us in states and federal offices that will also be on the ballot this year. And really, I think, drives a stark contrast that underlines, what democracy is all about. It's about a government that trusts the people to make our decisions for ourselves.
Secretary Benson, you're from Michigan, most important voter bosses. How do you feel at the end of these 4 days? How are you feeling about the state of the race?
Well, I'll just say, this week in Chicago, for me, was, among many things, a celebration of women, uplifting women. It's what we've lived through in Michigan these last several years, and the success, the results for all that come from women working together and supporting each other, trusting each other, and lifting each other up. Because, you've got Peggy Flanagan, poised to become the next governor of Minnesota. You've got Abigail Spanberger, poised to become the next governor of Virginia. You've got an extraordinary moment for women leadership. And you have women who led the way, like Hillary Clinton, like Jennifer Granholm, and others also being, and of course, our governor, currently Gretchen Whitmer. So this, the power of women's voices in this moment is a really beautiful one. And the unity of those voices is also something that I think we're going to see carry through multiple elections, as well as multiple offices that are on the ballot this fall.
Michigan Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson, it's great to get to talk to you after the week that was. And David Jolly, always great to talk to you. Thank you both so much for starting us off today. The Rev sticks around a little bit longer. Up next for us, for people wrongly accused and incarcerated whose lives were forever upended and changed by Donald Trump, took the stage at the DNC last night with a powerful message to the American people. Quote, Donald Trump has never changed and he never will, they said.
Where Republican campaign dollars are pouring into Trump's own pocket. More than 150 congressional candidates and political groups have spent millions at Trump properties and associated businesses, according to a CNN analysis of federal campaign finance data, with 2024 on track to be the biggest year of spending since 2016. The vast majority of the candidates are Republican and most endorsed by Trump.
A boom for Trump and Marino is a boom to put America first.
A clear example is Ohio businessman Bernie Marino, a political novice who made his fortune selling luxury cars. The same month Marino announced his run for the U.S. Senate last year, he spent $13,000 on event catering at Trump's Mar-a-Lago. The same day one of the payments was made, Trump posted on Truth Social, Marino is a highly respected businessman who was thinking of running for the Senate. Trump endorsed Marino months later, calling him a MAGA fighter. 2 days after the endorsement, Marino spent $17,000 at Mar-a-Lago, and a month later, $80,000 more on a fundraiser at the private club attended by some in Trump's inner circle.
We asked him to come here to Florida so we could bring him here to the president's home, so we could share him with you.
Marino is now locked in a competitive battle for Ohio's Senate seat with Trump by his side.
He's a hero, he's a winner.
That coincidence of the significant spending nearly coinciding with the Trump endorsement doesn't prove beyond a reasonable doubt that there's been a bribe. That pattern does and should raise questions in the minds of voters about what's really going on here.
The incredible candidate. Gotta do everything.
10% off your first purchase. Love it or return it.
U.S. greatest ex-president. He invokes the title of the miniseries in Bound the Five Spike to clear their names. When they see us, watch.
Together, on November 5th, we will usher in...
California Closets. We did it for Deborah, and we did it for you.
Touch us all personally, and that comes out in the way that he speaks. He's an authentic individual that speaking to a crowd of people like you might speak to people in a diner somewhere. And he's always going to speak what's on his mind and have a lot of authenticity every single day.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's no question when you're at those events, you're listening to a former president. That's exactly like his supporters live for it. They are there by the thousands. The question I had, though, with this event specifically, you know, you had the vice president, President Chican, Jenny Vance was there, gave a very kind of well-thought-out, coherent speech about the former president's first-term foreign policy. Keith Kellogg, former general commander of the Indo-Pacific Network Division, who was an advisor to the former president, did so as well. When people listened to the former president, what people took away was stuff like that, besides not him talking about the actual policy itself. Is that a problem?
The president is going to speak about what's on his mind on that day. But luckily for us, he's out there speaking every single day to crowds of people, answering questions, being off the cuff. He's not hiding in a basement. He's not getting in front of the cameras. If you don't find something on policy that you want to hear from him today, you'll probably hear it tomorrow or the next day or the next day, because he runs that kind of schedule day to day. And again, I just go to the point that he's going to speak what's on his mind, and that's the authenticity that we love, and we want to see that continue. You don't want to rehearse the president when it comes to somebody that you want to see have strong foreign policy, because that means if they're rehearsed, all of those foreign intelligence agencies, they're going to look at somebody that can't think on their feet, that's not going to be able to make an impromptu decision. They're going to read them like they read President Biden right now. Instead, when we see President Trump, they know a red line is a red line for that man. They know if he says, you know, you roll the dice, you're going to pay for it. They roll the dice, they are going to pay for it. That's what Russia's intelligence assesses about him. That's what China's intelligence assesses about him. Iran, North Korea, and everybody else that makes him the strongest national security president.
I wanted to ask you, served our country, wounded, and also served our country, and my appreciation for your service doesn't have any limits on some level. The former president was talking about the Medal of Freedom, which honors civilians, and said it was, quote, much better than the Medal of Honor that's given to service members. This is what he said.
It's actually much better because everyone didn't sneak your question.
North Main Street.
Wants a Purple Heart, which I have, or wants a Medal of Honor. Do you know anybody that wants one?
No, it's a fair question. No.
You don't. You don't go into service saying, man, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to earn that Medal of Honor. You don't, because most people receive it posthumously, or they come back extremely injured or having lost friends, same as the Purple Heart, not anywhere near to the level.
At the light, turn left onto Pennsylvania 104 North, North Main Street.
To get a Presidential Medal of Freedom, asking presidents, hey, can you put me in for the Presidential Medal of Freedom? Because people want it. And that's what he's saying. You know, the conditions that surround this, you don't have to see your friends die.
No, I understand that. My question in listening to it was, nobody aspires.
In 1,000 feet, turn right onto New Berlin Highway.
But what the award means and what it represents, in my mind at least, is very different from the Medal of Freedom.
I would 100% agree with you on that. And I bet if you ask the president,
turn
that
right
question,
onto New Berlin Highway,
different meanings surrounding each one of these, I think he would give you a different answer on that. He's put that medal around the neck of.
Continue on New Berlin Highway for 7 miles.
He had the conversations with him.
Continue on Pennsylvania 104 North for 9 miles.
Very reflective about the cost that it has on the service member, that it's not something that you want to see your friends come home underneath wide draped coffins. It's something important to reflect on. And I think that's actually reflected in him not wanting to take us into wars without calculating the cost of who won't come home, or the treasure that it will cost America, or what it will do to foreign policy. He is an expert on calculating those things and assessing what the foreign adversaries want to see done.
Yeah, the national security debate and contrast certainly will be a focus in the next 70+ days. Republican Congressman Brian Massey, I believe you just won your primary, and again, congrats on that. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Several Secret Service employees have now been reassigned weeks after the assassination attempt on former President Trump. What we're learning about the communication failures just minutes before the shooting. That's next.
sort of the sick world of Donald Trump's MAGA?
Well, that's a wonderful question, Nicole. It has everything to do with certain assumptions about the place that black people should occupy. It has certain assumptions about government putting its thumb on the scale to allow black success that we're not innately, we don't have the capacity to achieve excellence, and so we have to have the help of some other folks. So it carries with it the weight of our history. And I think what was so extraordinary about the convention is that it wasn't heavy-handed in the various ways in which it described MAGA and it being saturated in racial grievance. It really just simply made the point directly. Affirmative action, generational wealth, he's uncomfortable with successful black folks, or even the way in which the Central Park Five were brought out. I mean, think about it. That was layered with meaning. One, it happened in the context in which there was a celebration of her status of being a prosecutor. And here we have an example of prosecutorial misconduct. And other examples, of course, these young men were caught up in the midst of a moral and social panic. Remember, they were wild and quote-unquote supposedly wild, and they were the super predators, and how that moral panic generated a response by the criminal justice system that led to these young men, these teenagers, being drafted, being arrested and imprisoned in some ways, right? So we got that, and all the while that's happening, think about how Mrs. Salam ended. Think about what Court Wise, his baseball cap. How did Yusuf Salam, how did it end the call? He said, God bless the United States. What baseball hat did Court Wise have on his head? USA. So here was an example of patriotism rooted in a kind of journey that would suggest that they might be a bit skeptical about the country, but they turned out to be the true patriots, not Donald Trump and his MAGA Republicans.
Well, and that was the message of the whole week, and that was the message delivered by the Republicans most frontally. It was the Republicans who said, doesn't make you a Democrat. I think Olivia Troy, you said, voting for Kamala Harris doesn't make you a Democrat. It makes you a patriot. Adam Kinzinger said, my party's soul has been smothered. How do you leave the week feeling? Do you feel hopeful?
Career track. So they are very technical exams. And then from a pool of candidates, they choose the ones with the best qualifications and the best exam results.
Who are they?
So there's a specific judiciary council inside the judicial power who oversees the election of judges at the federal level. This reform, and the reason why it is very controversial, is because the qualifications for federal judges, not local judges, and Supreme Court justices would be lowered. So the idea is that instead of having technical requirements and an experience inside the judicial system, the people that would be applying would have less years of experience. Some would not even have a requirement of experience inside the judicial system, so they wouldn't have the qualifications.
And they would, I understand, be elected by popular vote, is that right?
That is correct. The three powers, executive power, legislative power, and judicial power, would propose a set of candidates that meet the requirements. And then after that, this pool of candidates would go on popular vote.
Why is the president doing this, do you think?
So we have to understand that during the six-year term of Robeson Raj, he started sending to Congress a lot of reforms that did not fully comply with the legal legislative requirements. So the last check and balance for Mexico was the Supreme Court, which successfully managed to stop a lot of Robeson Raj's reforms, and also because he wants to have more control of the judiciary and elect people that his party would not specifically appoint.
Hence the alarm. in the United States and indeed Canada, I understand the Canadian ambassador has intervened about the consequences of this for the judiciary in Mexico.
Yes, correct. First, we need to understand that Mexico, since 2023, is the United States' first trading partner. So this reform would directly affect U.S. economic interests because as Mexico, Canada, and the U.S. are part of the United Mexico-Canada Agreement, the famous USMCA that replaced NAFTA, the USMCA requires all the three countries to have an independent and effective judicial system. So if this reform is approved and it doesn't grant judicial autonomy, then the USMCA could be under serious trouble.
It could collapse.
Yes, and also taking into account that the USMCA is having a 2026 review, so this topic could be very controversial in the review.
This is just a proposal at the moment, but it could very well become law next month. Does the president and his party have the numbers to pass it into law?
The Congress is divided in two chambers. The lower chamber, the president does have the numbers, and in the upper chamber, he is two senators away, which he will likely obtain from other parties. So in September, it's most probable that the reform will pass.
Maria Calderon from the Mexico Institute at the Wilson Center. Now, snail mail is a term used to describe communication sent by post rather than email. But how about this for snail mail? A postcard that has taken more than a century to deliver to the address of what is now the Swansea Building Society headquarters in Wales. Henry Darby is a spokesman for the company.
Well, getting at the head office of a building society, Swansea Building Society, gets lots of mail on a regular basis, and within Friday's pile, a postcard drops out, and we realised pretty quickly Miss Lydia Davis didn't work for the society board, so the postcard was only 21 years old.
Goodness me, so who is the postcard from?
The postcard is signed off by Hewitt, US only. I believe I spoke to the sender's grandson yesterday. I can't confirm that, but he believes to be the grandson following retiring recently. He started to look into his family tree and his...
In a quarter mile, turn right onto Chestnut Street.
Well, in South Wales, a lot of men go by their middle name. And it turns out that he was a younger sibling of Lydia, we believe.
Is the postcard legible? I mean, could you read it to me?
Yeah, I can read what I can understand. Obviously, it's...
Turn right onto Chestnut Street.
...not commonly used today, but this is what I believe it says. Dear L, I could not. It was impossible to get the pair of these. I am sorry, but I hope you're enjoying yourself at home. I have now got 10 shillings, we believe it means, shorthand, pocket money, not counting the train fare, so I'm doing all right. Love from Hewitt.
Now, it seems your detective work on the sender has paid off, but what about the recipient, Lydia Davis?
So, Lydia was 16 at the time. We think from the 1901 census, that would make sense. Her younger brother was 13, so sending a card to his eldest sibling. She later got married, moved to London with a man who owned a hotel in Pall Mall, and then...
Continue for 8 miles.
Maybe local archives between England and Wales don't share details as frequently as expected, because that's kind of where Lydia's story stops. So we think, we have had lots of people reaching out from our social media drive, people who believe to be potentially her great-great-niece, and actually today, a national genealogy company reached out to tell me they think they found Lydia's grandson.
And why do you think that this postcard has taken so long to arrive, more than a century?
This is actually the one mystery that we've had no leads on when it comes to our push to find out more about it. It came in immaculate condition. It's not stained at all, it's not bent. There is no evidence of it being the age it is, other than, you know, we've got King Edward VII is the stamp, and what we believe is potentially, and I think the Royal Mail have also said this, rather than it being lost within their system for 121 years, it's potentially re-entered their system. How that's come to be, we're not sure. My guess would be it's potentially been used as a bookmark. maybe someone's then purchased this book from an antique shop and gone, oh wow, look at this address, I wonder if this still exists, I bet whoever lives there now would love it. And what actually happens is it's turned up at Swansea Building Society. We think Lydia's house may have been destroyed in World War II, but because our office was built in the exact same location, the address remained the same, and that's kind of how it ended up with us.
Henry Darby, ending this edition of News Hour.
This is the BBC World Service, and on the inquiry this week...
I'm William Crawley. A secret deal between the Catholic Church and China is up for renewal. A deal that profoundly affects who China's 13 million Catholics answer to. Is Pope Francis betraying China's Catholics?
The inquiry at bbcworldservice.com/inquiry. In 30 minutes, heart and soul.
Liberal Malone claims that he uncovered evidence of cardinals lining their own pockets, as well as other major financial mismanagement while working with Pope Francis at the Vatican. Hear his story.
Next, it's Hard Soul. This is the BBC World Service, the world's radio station.
After the news from the BBC World Service, it's Hard Talk with me, Stephen Sacker. To fully commit to a cause is to put the political above the personal, and it has lifelong ramifications, not just for the activist, but for those closest to them. And no one knows this better than my guest today, the writer Gillian Slobo, whose parents, Joe Slobo and Ruth First, were hugely important figures in South Africa's liberation struggle against apartheid.
It's not easy to be the child of revolutionaries, and they make decisions. I don't think it is easy to be a revolutionary with children, actually. They make decisions that they know will impact on their family. But actually, in the end, I'm really proud of what they did. I lived in a very traumatic childhood, at the same time, an extremely privileged one.
That's Gillian Slogan on Hard Talk after the news.
Stuart McIntosh with the BBC News. Hello. The independent candidate for the US presidency, Robert F. Kennedy Jr., has suspended his electoral campaign and thrown his support to Donald Trump. Mr. Kennedy said he'll remove his name from 10 states where his presence would be a spoiler to Mr. Trump's effort. Speaking at a campaign event in Las Vegas, Mr. Trump welcomed the endorsement.